I'm Uta Franke. I'm a human geneticist, originally from Germany, as you can hear. And I'm an emeritus professor here at Stanford and also senior medical director at 23andMe. You know, there were early estimates of the size of the genome simply by measuring the amount of DNA in a cell. People could do that a long time ago. And so the estimate was in that range of 3 billion base pairs. But the idea to actually sequence it came up in the mid-80s, when capillary sequencing was developed, and many people thought it was an absolutely crazy idea because it's so huge, so much information. The other thing to know about the Human Genome Project, when it finally got started around 1990, the first 5 years were devoted to just mapping the chromosomes. You know, people heard about chromosomes, and we know that DNA runs in chromosomes from one end to another. So it would make sense, logical sense, to start sequencing at one end and then go through. But instead, what people did, they made maps of the chromosomes, and then you could focus in on specific region and do the sequencing there. And also to find genes that are located in specific chromosome regions.
I see. So instead of having to sort of, like you say, sequence from one end to the other, you could have many starting places in the middle of a chromosome and sort of read out from there.
Right, and you could relate the sequence to the chromosomal features because chromosomes, when they are treated with a certain agent, display banding patterns that are very unique. Therefore, we can identify each chromosome individually, which is something you cannot do when they are uniformly stained. And also, we can see within each chromosome there are certain regions. And now we can find out in which region certain genes are located. And all of this physical mapping, as it's called, was done before the sequencing even started.
So what happened when the sequencing project started? You mentioned it was an international collaboration. Was this really countries all over the world, or were they more from one region or another, or?
Well, there were countries who had developed infrastructure to take on such a big project. And in Europe, it was predominantly the UK, France, and Germany, and Canada was a player, as well as Japan and China. And all of these people got together under the chairmanship, so to say, of Francis Collins, who is now the director of the NIH. He was organizing this big international thing and made sure there wasn't too much waste and duplication. They were dividing up the chromosomes. Like, here you do chromosome 21. Okay, that's where we are focusing on. And then they had regular meetings, they exchanged information. All the results were immediately shared and put online. And therefore, because of this international effort, this led to success.
Where are we now with sequencing the human genome or many human genomes? Are we multiple drafts beyond, and are we reaching out to many people?
The international effort had many different people involved. So the genome is a composite of sequences of many individuals. And that's called the reference genome. But what you really want to know is, what is different between the genomes of different people who live in different parts of the world? And that was the next effort then, to really sequence individuals with known ethnic background and find out what are the variations between humans. And that's when it really became interesting. And that took another 10 years to become really useful to have that information.
What does the size of a genome mean? Does it mean anything at all?
Well, there are some organisms with huge genomes, like the salamanders, you know. And what is all that sequence? It probably has no informational content. Sometimes genomes get big because viruses get in and they replicate, they make copies of themselves, and that has no useful function. So there is only a smaller part of the genome that's really important because it has function, and this is something we're still working on unraveling the functions.
You also mentioned repetitive DNA when you were talking about some of, I guess, the historical context of the genome, and even once we sequenced it, if anyone does any research on their own, they might find that there's still a lot of repetitive regions. What do we know about those in the genome?
You know, most of them are just remnants. I mean, there were copies made of some early viral intruder, and now they are degenerated. There are bits and pieces of them. But there are still some active copies. And what they can do, they can still make copies of themselves and they can jump around and insert somewhere else in the genome and actually cause problems. They can cause disease by inserting into an important protein coding genes. So we are not done with dealing with all these repetitive sequences. They're still changing. And that means there is huge variability from one person to another as well.
I think that's an amazing concept, too, to think about our genomes. We sort of think of them as, okay, we have the static genome, mm-hmm. and it may interact with itself to create a protein or regulation, but the genome itself is changing. Even today, like you said, this idea of moving elements.
It's still evolving.